And welcome back to another video of jPlay. I'm Marcus, and today I'm gonna join various gods from various cultures and finally trying to get Immortal, a game that recently launched on Kickstarter. And as I don't have any cover to show you, I decided to show you the cover in the background here. And as usual, I will walk you through some actual rounds rather than giving you a normal review, and basically I'm not really good at it. So let's have a look what ships with Immortal. In Immortal, each player chooses a so-called pantheon from different mythologies such as the Greek, Japanese, Norse or Native Americans. But bear in mind that the set I'm showing is only the beginning, as other sets with other cultures are already planned. Needless to say that you are looking at prototype components, although I think some of the cards seem to really represent the final artwork and I really like it. You can play Immortal with 2 to 4 players, and usually each player chooses one complete pantheon, but there are also some deck building variants available that allow a mixed deck of 2 different cultures. Also pretty neat. During the game, players play cards or mythological figures from their hands to the battlefields, which can look quite different each time you play because of the modular boards, which are also double-sided with a basic and a more advanced side with some of those special abilities. Each game consists of 2 so-called acts that last until either all spaces on the battlefield are occupied or one player has no more cards in his hand at the start of a turn. Either way, the act will immediately end, and whoever controls the most cards on the battlefield after 2 acts will be immortal, and of course the winner of this match. But enough of the introduction, let's dive into the really quick setup and some demo rounds of Immortal. I decided to walk you through some rounds of a 2-player game and decided to go with Japanese and the Native American pantheons. The players choose a color, so here we have black versus orange, and then we prepare the decks. Each pantheon consists of exactly 18 cards, where 9 of those are level 1 cards and will be used for Act 1. There are 6 cards for level 2 and 3 for level 3. Those 2 will be used in Act 2 of the battle. So basically the players will shuffle their 9 level 1 cards and draw 5 of them, and this is their starting hand. Let's do that now. And the remainder of the cards will be used only in Act 2. Determine a starting player and let him choose a battlefield tile. And normally you're really free to choose the side, so if you're going with a basic or the advanced side, but you can also agree only to use a specific side. So in this example, let's say orange, the Native American player will choose this tile, and then black will choose his battlefield tile accordingly. And you have to place each new battlefield tile that at least 2 edges will touch. So for example, this wouldn't be allowed, but this is fine, this would be fine. But as black is the Japanese player, he decides to leave one of those void spaces here. Void space is basically every tile or every space that is not really on the battlefield but is touching the battlefield. This is a void space, this is a void space, and this would also be a void space. And here both players have decided to choose the Omega side, so the more advanced side of a tile that shows some so-called sacred spaces, which provide additional abilities or can affect the strength of a card. Basically, each player will place a tile. So in a 3-player game, there would be 3 starting tiles that represent the actual battlefield. After the board phase, we can directly start into the battle phase of Act 1, which is slightly different to the battle phase of the later Act 2. In the very first round, each player places 1 card face down on an empty space on the battlefield. And it's important to mention that some cards that are played face down will not trigger their special ability, such as the Voidwalker or the Skinwalker, for example. So sometimes it's best to play a card without any special abilities. It's also important to mention that the first player to play a card face down on the battlefield determines the board orientation. So when he plays a card facing north, all other players have to play their cards accordingly. There's a variant in the rules that allows to play the cards in north or south orientation, which can be pretty interesting too, but in this walkthrough I stick to the standard rule. So let's place the first card of the orange player, and he will place that here on this sacred space, which will provide him a special ability. But as he placed his card face down, the special ability will be triggered when this card will be revealed in the next step of this very first round. And you see the northern direction of a face down card by looking where the feathered wing is. So in this example, this would be the northern direction of the battlefield for the remainder of this game. After playing a card, you are allowed to draw a card from your draw deck, which belongs to the current act, which is Act 1. So normally you would always have 5 cards available. Of course, when your draw deck runs out, then you have to live with what is on your hand. And one thing I nearly forgot, of course, I have to mark the card with the appropriate color to let everyone know, okay, this card currently belongs to the orange player. After the first player played his first card, the other players play the first card face down on the board, following the same orientation. During this first placement, no cards must be placed adjacent to another card. Adjacent means edge touching edge. So diagonal placement is fine though. So I think let's do that here. So the Japanese player, being black, will place his card here. We mark that appropriately with a stone. And if there are any sacred spaces, it can be wise to not use them during your very first turn, especially if it's an ability space, because some of those abilities don't trigger, but in this case, this is not really a problem. Placing cards on a dominion space, which I did here, that is the same as the card's dominion, can be a pretty good idea though. So let's be surprised when I reveal those cards. After playing a card, you're still allowed to draw a new card, and this is the 5th card for the Japanese player. Okay, let's reveal the cards first with the orange player. And as you can see, the orange player now gets the counterattack special ability, and this special ability is additional to the special ability of the deer woman here. So we will place an counterattack marker on the card accordingly. Okay, let's reveal the card of the Japanese player, and here we see that the dominion of the card matches the dominion of the sacred space. That's definitely a very good thing. So all strength of these cards are now increased by 1. So we have here a 4, a 3, a 4, and a 6. It was really not a very good idea to play this card here, because the strong north side now is facing to a void space, and only the Japanese player has the void ability at this point in time. So I think he will never be able to leverage this side. But I really only wanted to demonstrate you what happens if you play a card on those dominion spaces that matches them. But now we have to look at the special ability of the deer woman here, which is the trickster. And the trickster allows to change the dominion of the cards that are in the area of effect. And in this case, this would be the diagonal spaces here. And guess what? Orange decided to change the dominion of this Kodama here to the water dominion, which means it no longer matches the dominion on the sacred space. And this also means, for once, he will lose this +1 marker, and instead he gains a -1 marker. So all those strength are now decreased by 1 level. Really a very clever move of the orange player. Let's play the next card for the orange player, and I think he will go with this Wendigo here. And now we will see our first attack. So basically you check if you have enemy figures that are adjacent to you. Again, adjacent means only edge touching edge. In this case, the only animal creature on the board is this Kodama here. Of course, again, I forgot to mark this Wendigo here. Then you compare all the strength values of these edges that are touching in this point in time. Here we have a 5, here we have a 2 because of this minus 1 of this one. So this means the Wendigo just defeated the Kodama, which means this is now being a prisoner. And you see that orange has a strong force on the board, and you also see that orange has now very strong spaces on the board. So when black now will play something here, he really has to play a very strong card in order to defeat this Wendigo, and the same would count here. Unfortunately, the special ability of this Kodama here, so basically gain plus 1 in defense and offense when fighting against this lightning dominion here, does not count because the Wendigo is also from the fire dominion. Okay, the Japanese player also has a very clever card on his hand. So he plays Kitsune on the board here. So for once he will mark that Kitsune belongs to him, and again Kitsune will attack the Wendigo here, and here you see 6 versus 5. That's definitely a clear statement, so this Wendigo is being captured. Now the swiftness special ability will trigger, which allows her to move 1 space up or 1 space to the south, and I think we will move her down here to the Deer Woman. And again, we will have a full defense or full offense here. So again, 6 versus 2, which means this Deer Woman is also being captured. This counterattack ability will only trigger if you are, let's say, defending from an attack successfully. So saying you have more strength than your attacker. In this case, this counterattack will then mean you would start an attack against the defender, and in this case, of course, you would normally also win this fight. And normally all the other cards do not fight back, so if you don't have fighting power to defeat your defender, this defender will do nothing basically in return. And it's also important to mention that when you place a card, you battle all adjacent cards. So basically, if there would be 2 cards here, and when I would have played this Wendigo, he would have attacked all the enemy cards that are around it. Okay, let's see. Orange will play this Arclute here. Then we will have a fight between Arclute and Kitsune, and he has definitely more power than Kitsune, though he or she is captured by Arclute, and he's also feeling pretty confident that this 5 might be enough to protect it from the black player. Coming back to the Japanese player, and the Japanese player will also do something very tricky. Again, he will play Hanya, and Hanya is a so-called void walker, which means you are allowed to place her on a void space that is touching the actual battlefield. So you can really search for the brackets and search for the weak spots of your enemy. In this case, Hanya is definitely stronger here than Arclute, so we can definitely take him prisoner as well. And in this case, we are not allowed to keep Hanya because after the attack, so in the post-attack phase, basically, she will be removed from the game. But I think this was definitely a good exchange because this is a very strong creature on the board, which is definitely hard to capture. I'm not really sure if that's a good idea, but really the remaining hand and the setup of the board doesn't allow for any clever move for the orange player. So I think he will play the Mishibishui, and I'm really apologizing if I'm pronouncing this all incorrectly. Definitely no offense here. So as I, of course, I have to claim it, and as the dominion of this card matches the dominion of the sacred space, he gets a plus 1. That's definitely something. He has the champion ability, but this doesn't really help him at this point in time because he would get plus 1 for each adjacent dominion creature around, and this really counts for enemy and friendly units. But in this case, he would only gain a plus 1, and this wouldn't help him against the Wendigo here. But I know for now this should be okay. Okay, let's see. The Japanese player will play Komainu, and this would allow him to attack Kitsune successfully. So both are now under his control. It's really looking good for the black player. But this game is really all about gaining control, losing control, and in the end it's more or less a relatively balanced out situation. It's really tough for me because I'm now playing with both sides and I know what the other guy is thinking, or basically myself and thinking, so please don't take this as any strategic tip or whatsoever. So I'm really just want to show you the core mechanics of this game. Okay, I think the Native American player, so Orange, will play the Kachinas, which has the Shaman ability, which protects him basically against a lot of those special abilities. First of all, let's claim it accordingly and then trigger the attacks. And I think that's pretty clear. So that's a 4 versus a 2. So the Deer Woman is captured again. Here we have a 4, here we have a 5. So he is not successful. If this Aklut now would have the counterattack ability, then he would now strike back and would defeat Kachinas instead. Okay, Japan is playing Kappa. And because this is a sacred space, the Kappa also gets the traitor special ability. Again, we will trigger all the attacks. In this case, this will attack, or the Kappa will attack the Kachinas. And unfortunately, in this case, the Shaman special ability doesn't help him. So he's getting, So he's definitely captured, but in this case, as this is the traitor card, this card is removed and put on top of the deck of the attacker. So again, we have one empty space on the board, and the attacker now has one card more in his deck. Still, there's not much what the Native American player can do. So he will play the Tarkek here. He will trigger the attack accordingly. So he will capture the Kappa. But still, as you can see, the game is completely balanced again. Okay, Japan will play the Hachiman here. And here we see he has a +1 strength and defense against water dominion spaces, and luckily the Kappa guy is. So in this case, he's definitely able to capture the Kappa again. Normally, if you have a tie, nothing bad would happen. Okay, it's the turn of the Native American player, and he still has something in his back pocket. So he will now play the Silver Fox, which has the Skinwalker ability, which means you are allowed to place that on top of your existing creature. So let's do that right now. Of course, he still would inherit all the abilities from the underlying sacred space, so he still has the counter attack, and of course he would also trigger the attack again, which also means that the Wendigo now belongs to the Orange player. Awesome. Okay, Japanese player will play the Tango here, who has the Maelstrom ability, which means he can now change the orientation of an adjacent card in the area of influence. So here would be this space or that space by 180 degrees. So let's do that for this, whatever it is called. It has still a +1, so this would be a 3, but a 3 is definitely not enough for the 5 of the Mishi Bishwish. I don't know. So he definitely can't capture this creature again. Awesome. And as this is the last space of the battlefield of Act 1, it's only one turn left, and this belongs to the Native American player. And that's because for once of the special ability of the Skinwalker and of the Voidwalker here. So in some cases it's always not, and I think of course also for the traitor, which means normally each player has the same amount of actions, but in this case the Native American player is lucky. So the Native American player plays the Whirlwind here, and the Whirlwind has more than enough fighting power to regain control over this creature. And now we count who controls the most creatures on the board, and in this case we have a clear tie, which means during Act 2 the starting player will be the player who started last the first act, basically, and which would mean the Japanese player will go first. Now that we are at the end of Act 1, all the cards that are still from Act 1 are being sent to the underworld, basically the discard pile. And starting with the first player, each player is now allowed to add one additional tile to the battlefield. So the Japanese player will decide to be very aggressive and place this battlefield here. So these creatures are now all under or in danger. Again, basically, of course, this will also affect him, but also will give him some opportunities to regain some of these cards here, which are definitely important. And as you can see, he also decided to go with the Omega side of the battlefield tile. And the Native American player decided to play this tile here, and this is now the Alpha side of the side, so this doesn't provide any special abilities or Dominion sacred spaces. Each player will shuffle his level 3 cards and put them on the bottle, then he takes the level 2 cards, give them a shuffle as well, and place them on top of the level 3 card, and this will now be the draw deck for act number 2, which means you start always with level 2 cards, but sooner or later you will discover your level 3 cards, which are pretty powerful, by the way. Again, each player is allowed to draw 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 cards, and this is now his starting hand, and then the battle phase starts again. And this is now different to the battle phase, or the first round of the battle phase of Act 1. Your very first card is placed face up like normal, so you can directly trigger an attack. And I think this is what the Japanese player will do. So he will play Kirin here. He will play his on the sacred Dominion space. This matches the Dominion of the card, so he gains a plus 1, and of course he's also allowed to capture the Kodama here, and he also has an attack and defense value against those lightning creatures. Of course, the Native American player also has a very nice card on his hand, so he plays the Raven, which is a shaman again. Of course, we again trigger 2 attacks at this point in time, so here is definitely more powerful than the other one. He has a plus 1 but also a minus 1, because he would have a plus 1 defense against those Lightning Dominion cards, but he's losing one because his Dominion is not matching the sacred space. But don't talk about it, he's definitely captured, and the same would be here towards the south against the Kappa, who is also not strong enough to stand the Raven. And yeah, this would now go on until, again, all spaces on the battlefield are either occupied, or if one of the players doesn't have any more cards on his hand, this would immediately trigger the end of the game, and then you would see who has the most cards on the battlefield, so whoever controls the most cards is the winner. In case of a tie, then you directly check who has the stronger cards on the battlefield. So for example, this level 2 Raven here is worth 2 victory points, whereas the Tango is worth only 1 victory point, being a level 1 creature. Some final words about Immortal, but again, I will keep them short and crisp. As mentioned, Immortal is currently on Kickstarter, so please check out the description of this video to find the link to the campaign, and there should be a YouTube card popping up any second now as well. As mentioned, some components are still prototype quality, and some of the actual artwork is not finished or served as a placeholder like this one. But what's already finished is really nice to look at. Some artwork seems to be coming from some geek stream, but I guess I'm a geek too, so I actually like it. I'm not sure what other master sets will show up in the course of the campaign or possibly afterwards, but the starting decks play pretty differently from each other. In my beta rules, there are already several rule variants, like the deck building or the team variant. And there are also rules for a quick skirmish variant, but not that the standard game is very long as well. But overall, there's really a great replayability when you change some of the core rules, and especially the deck building, and also the variant where you are allowed to play the card either orientation is also very, very interesting. I've also only showed you a little portion of all the special abilities that come with a base game. So for example, the Greek come with a ranged attack or this Phalanx special ability. And I also haven't showed you the Scar special ability. Any unit with a Slayer ability can also be pretty deadly, as it will remove any enemy cards that it defeats, and this can open up some new available spaces on the battlefield in order to place an additional card for you. So this is also a very strategic element in this game. I really hope you enjoyed my little walkthrough here and hope it motivated you to check out the Kickstarter campaign accordingly. Again, you find the link in the description of this video. Hope to see you soon in one of my next videos, and until then, bye bye.